بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Continue our reading from the path of worshippers منهاج العابدين, and we are still reading within the sixth obstacle of the value of factors that impair and ruin worship. And the very last thing that we have read the last time is that people will be raised on the day of judgment at three courts. One that scrutinizes good and virtuous deeds, and one that looks into sins, and a third that I would say pertains to all goods and virtuous deeds. And I mentioned that the translator said that this is about reward, and that there is a possibility, a good possibility, a strong possibility, I would say, that really the good deeds will be matched with in fact the good deeds will be lined against the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has bestowed on people. And every because they are innumerable, that we will never be able to count all of them. We cannot enumerate all the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it is sight, whether it's the ability to speak in itself, the tongue, and every function in our body, anything about the sustenance, the offspring, family, a friend is a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At any rate, every good deed will be aligned against one of these gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until there is no more good deeds, and all that remains will be the bad deeds, the sins. And ultimately, it is up to divine will what will happen to these sins, that these bad deeds. And we continue. Imam Ghazali said, "Rahmahullah, wa amma ayyubun nafs wa afatuha, faqad qaddamnaha fi babiha." Wal amru al makhuf. أن العبد يكدح ويدأبو 70 سنة غافلا عن عيوبه وآفاته, فربما لا يكون واحد منها مقبولا, وربما يتعب أعواما فتفسد تفسد بساعة واحدة. وأعظم خطرا ذلك كله أنه ربما ينظر الله تعالى إلى العبد وهو يرائي الناس بعبادته وخدمته, حيث جعل ظاهره لله وقلبه باطنه للخلق, فيطرده طردا لا مرد له والعياذ بالله. Earlier we discussed the imperfections of the soul and detailed the calamities it may face. The frightening thing is that the servant of God accepts all hardships in his worship, yet remains negligent of his imperfections for 70 years. He always fears lest a single prayer may not be accepted, and that he may spoil a year of labor in a single moment. A greater danger than this is that God sees His servant fool people with His worship, in the sense that outwardly he worships God, but inwardly he does it to impress people. God will reject such a servant in such a way that will be no return for him. We take refuge in God from this. Indeed, if one wastes one's life thinking that he or she is doing well, while it's really about show off, that will devastate one's worship. It's not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولقد سمعت بعض العلماء يحكي عن الحسن البصري رحمه الله تعالى أنه رؤية في المنام بعد موته، فسئل عن حاله فقال أقامنا الله تعالى بين يديه وقال يا حسن أتذكر يوم كنت تصلي في المسجد إذ رمق الناس بأبصارهم فزدت حسنا لصلاتك، فلولا أن أول صلاتك كان لي خالصا لطردتك اليوم عن بابي ولقطعتك عني مرة واحدة. Once I heard scholars say that he had a dream of Hassan al-Basri, who is really one of the most prominent scholars. And definitely a theologian, preacher, but of course he was amongst the Ubbad, the worshippers. When I zakar Allah ahada, he saw him in a dream. After he passed away, he asked about his state, and Hassan said, God called me to his presence and said, do you remember a day that you prayed in the mosque, and you prayed better because people were watching you? They had a glance, ramaqaka, just simply a glance at you, and you improved your prayer. If the first course of your prayer was not sincere for me alone, I would have turned you away from my gate today and would have cut off all connection with you once and for all. So it's improving one's prayer for a glance once. ولما كان الأمر في الجملة من الدقة والصعوبة لحد عظيم. Now we go back to Imam Ghazali's narrative. نظر أولو الأبصار فيه فخافوا على أنفسهم حتى إن منهم من لا يلتفت لجميع ما يظهر للناس من أعماله. حتى حكي عن الرابعة أنها قالت ما ظهر من أعمالي لا أعده شيئا. In short, since it is difficult to worship God with sincerity and purity, intention and purity of intention, people of intellect often become fearful for their soul to the extent that if they prayed and people became aware of it, they did not count that course of prayer. It is narrated that Rabi' al-Adawiyah said, if any of my deeds became known to people, I did not count it. Meaning that one should be keen to hide it in order to keep it as sincere as possible for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rabi is very famous for her statements about her the nature of her worship, the nature of her relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, it's a story of love, as it should be. And I think Muslim scholars should, you know, speak more about love in the Quran and the Sunnah. And there are books published about this issue. So the problem is not that it's non-existent. The problem is that we don't speak about it enough. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how this translates, of course, the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the love of Ahl la ilaha illallah, the people of la ilaha illallah. And loving that which is that one loves for himself, it's a different issue, but it is it should be a story of love. وقال آخر اكتم حسناتك كما تكتم سيئاتك. And someone else said, hide your good deeds as you hide your evil deeds. Of course, this is about the time when people were ashamed of their deeds and today people brag about their bad deeds. They go on TV, and if there is no one interviewing them, they simply say it about themselves anyhow, and they publish it on social media. They literally, there's nothing that they are not willing to expose on, you know, in front of the camera. What a shame. وآخر يقول إن أمكانك أن تجعلك خبئا من الخير فافعل. And another one said, if it is possible for you to conceal your good deeds, do so. Well, both of them are concealing, hide and conceal. But the sense we get from khib, almost like you store something, you hide it from people. You simply as a reserve, you know, for a day that you will need. And this is about the good deed. In fact, it's almost as if you are hiding it in a place where no one will know about it for that day, for the day of judgment. That will be absolutely pure for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have not mentioned this to anyone, not your spouse, not your children, not your parents. You just simply have something, you know, a good deed, and not only one in particular, but to have good deeds hidden. Rabah is again is asked, بما تربحين أكثر مما ترتجين فقالت بيأسي من جل عملي. So she was asked which of her deeds she considered the most hopeful and promising. She replied, my most hopeful deed is that I have no hope in my deeds. My most hopeful deed is that I have no hope in my deeds. In Arabic, it said "jul," most. So she has no hope in most of her deeds. وحكي أنه اجتمع محمد أو محمد بن واسع ومالك بن دينار فقال مالك إما الطاعة وإما النار. فقال محمد بن واسع إما رحمة الله أو النار. فقال مالك ما أحوجني إلى معلم مثلك. It is narrated that once محمد بن واسع and مالك بن دينار got together. مالك said, either we worship God and obey him, or else we go to hell. Muhammad bin Wasa replied, either God will have mercy on us or we will go to hell. Malik said, indeed, I need a teacher like you. It is not your action ultimately, it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The action, the deed is not good enough. One needs to worship, but it's not good enough. It's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And عن أبي يزيد البسطامي رحمه الله قال كابدت العبادة 30 سنة فرأيت قائلا يقول يا أبي يزيد خزائنه مملوءة من العبادة فإن أردت الوصول إليه فعليك بالذلة والافتقار. سبيد أبو يزيد بايزيد البسطامي سد. I heard my master أبو الحسن عبد المالك النيسابور الشافعي الجويني say that one day his teacher أبو الفضل said I think I jumped over the statement of Bastami. He said, I went through so much hardship and prayed for 30 years. Someone then said to me that God's treasure house is filled with the prayers of his servants. The worship, all forms of worship. If you wish to reach him, it is necessary that you humble yourself and enter the path of spiritual poverty. Enter the path of spiritual poverty. It might not capture the notion of iftiqar. Iftiqar is from faqr, from there is poverty here. But really, it's about being in a state of need, in the sense of needing the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not relying on one's deeds. It doesn't mean that one does not do his or her part, but the state of the heart is, I need divine mercy, I need divine, you know, God's forgiveness. Otherwise, the action itself is not on its own. You know, there should be no reliance on the action. وسمعت الأستاذ أبا الحسن يحكي عن الأستاذ أبا الفضل رحمه الله أنه كان يقول إني أعلم أن ما أعمله من الطاعات غير مقبولة عند الله تعالى. قيل له في ذلك فأجاب إني أعلم ما يحتاج إليه الفعل حتى يكون مقبولا وأعلم أني لست أقوم بذلك فعلمت أنها غير مقبولة. قيل له فلما تفعلها؟ قال عسى أن يصلحنا الله تعالى يوما فتكون النفس متعودة لعمل الخير فلا أحتاج إلى معودها ذلك من الرأس. It's a very strange statement. Not that it is unacceptable. So Imam Ghazali said that he heard his teacher. Imam al-Juwayni. Narrating on behalf of Abu al-Fadl Rahimullah, he said, I know all prayers that I perform are not accepted before God. Someone asked him how he knew that. He replied, because I know what qualifies our deeds to be accepted by God. I know and know that I do not meet those qualifications, these conditions, these. Someone else asked him why he then. He continued to pray. He replied, I worship God, hoping that one day he will guide me to righteousness, to act in a way that his form of worship will be accepted, so that I will not have to start afresh. فهذه حال هؤلاء الأعلام ذو المجاهدات والأقدار فكنت أنت كما قال الشاعر فاطلب لنفسك صحبة مع غيرهم وقع الإياس وخابت الآمال هيهات تدرك بالتواني سادة كد النفوس وساعد الإقبال. This was the state of those noblemen. Noblemen, also a'lam, they are the well-known and the men of spiritual struggle and spiritual will. And this is how your state should be. How eloquent, said the poet, if you see company of people rather than them, you will be disappointed and your deeds will be gone. Beware if for simple things that follow you prepare. Your soul will be exhausted and your fortune withdrawn. If for simple things that follow you prepare. The second verse, you cannot basically attain the status. I had to drop with Tawani said that you cannot attain the status of those non-worshippers, those noblemen, as it is mentioned here. You don't attain their status by taking your time, by delaying things, by postponing things, by taking it easy. They exhausted themselves, and the وساعد الإقبال, and they were basically very much after the they very much after this after worshiping, after service, after they were enthusiastic. They were so the opposite of Tawani at the beginning in the first part of the second verse. So that might help understand the Arabic text. ثم رأيت أني أثبت ها هنا الخبر المأثور عن الصادق المصدوق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه, وقد ذكرناه في غير كتاب. And here we have a hadith that is as long as 3.5 pages, one hadith. While in principle there could be a hadith like this in terms of length, but that is not the first of all, that's not the norm. And why I'm not going to read this hadith neither in Arabic nor in English is that it is forged. You know, several prominent scholars of the past and late scholars, pre-modern times and during modern times, all of them said that it is a forged tradition. And really, if we are going to use anything from the lines of poetry that we, the verses that we have just talked about, وقع الإياس, as if basically this hadith is about if anything will emerge from this tradition is that despair, you know, that there is no use. But at any rate, it's about rejecting the action one after the other. So since it is forged and it is that long, it will take us probably a couple of days of reading and commenting on it. And suffice it to say that this particular hadith that has been narrated here, it mentions that روي عن ابن المبارك رحمه الله عن رجل أنه قال لمعاذ. It has been narrated by Ibn al-Mubarak. and that a man who is not mentioned here, and the English translation it says that by the name of Khalid bin Madan, since the name of Khalid bin Madan is mentioned towards the end of the hadith commenting on this, he said, وكان معاذ لا يكثر من تلاوة القرآن كما يكثر من تلاوة هذا الحديث ذكري في مجلسه. That معاذ بن جبل would mention this hadith more than reciting the Quran. He keeps mentioning this particular hadith. Yes, so sometimes we have to drop these forged traditions. A list, basically, it will stick to someone's memory. And it did happen to me that I attended, you know, a halaqa in the mid-1970s. And the Sufi master at the time, I was really, I think it was after high school. And he did mention a hadith that later on I found that it was mawdu' forged tradition. And for whatever reason, I memorized that during that session. But Imam Ghazali says that this, after he mentioned this hadith, he summarizes, why not, basically. We can read Imam Ghazali's commentary. He said, O man of wisdom, when you hear this powerful hadith that trembles the heart, perplexes the intellect, and turns the soul helpless, take refuge in your master, who is the Lord of the worlds. Beseech, plead, and weep every day and night along with those who do so. For there is no rescue and salvation from this affliction except by God's mercy. No rescue exists from this ocean except by His grace, help, and mercy. So no rescue exists from this ocean except by His grace, help, and providence. Take heed and wake up from the slumber of negligence. Give this important affair due attention. Observe it as it deserves, and struggle with all your being in this dreadful valley, so that you will not be among those who are doomed for destruction. Seek God's help in all circumstances, for He is the best helper and the most merciful. And there is no power nor strength save in God, exalted and majestic is He. ولما سمعت أيها الرجل بهذا الحديث العظيم نبأه الكبير خطره الأليم أثره الذي تطير له القلوب وتحير له العقول وتضيق عن حمله الصدور وتجزع من هوله النفوس فاعتصم بمولاك إله العالمين والزم الباب بالتضرع والابتهال والبكاء أنا الليل وأطراف النهار مع المتضرعين والمبتهلين فإنه لا نجاة من هذا الأمر إلا برحمته ولا سلامة من هذا البحر إلا بنظره وتوفيقه وعنايته فتنبه من رغدة الغافلين وعقل الأمر حقه وجاهد نفسك في هذه العقبة المخوفة لعلك لا تهلك مع الهالكين والمستعان بالله تعالى على كل حال فإنه خير معين وتعالى أرحم الراحمين ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. Imam Ghazali here, he begins a new subtitle, if you will, topic, still within the same obstacle, the sixth obstacle. في بيان ما يصرف الإنسان عن الالتفات إلى الخلق والنفس وجملة الأمر إن أنك إذا أحسنت النظر فرأيت قدر طاعة الله تعالى ورأيت عجز الخلق وضعفهم وجهلهم فلا تلتفت إليهم بقلبك وكن زاهدا في ثنائهم ومدحهم وتعظيمهم الذي لا فائدة تحته فلا ترد بطاعتك شيئا من ذلك. I'm simply reading the first the introduction, if you will, introductory couple of lines, because we will continue inshallah tomorrow. In short, if you reflect, you will understand the value of being God, and you will realize the servant's helplessness, weakness, and ignorance. Do not become fascinated with the people, and avoid flattering or praising and admiring them, for there is no benefit in doing so. Never compromise your obedience to God for people's praise. Yes, inshallah, we'll continue this tomorrow, بإذن الله عز وجل. سبحانك الله وبحمدك، نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.